It's so amazing to be here today, and thank you for, my brother also thinks that, by the way. So what I wanted to do was, the brief to me was, if you could maybe, so I'm the CEO of Mumbai Angels Network, which is an angel investing and mentoring network, and we invest in startups, and we also mentor them, and it's a decade-long story. But I actually didn't want to talk so much about what we do as a work, because I didn't think this forum was something about what a company does. And because everybody here is sharing their life stories. So I thought it better be a little more intimate and a little more defining. And because a work is just what we do, not for who we are. So I just wanted to take this opportunity to share with you some of the life lessons that I've learned in my 20 years of not just working career, but also, you know, my formative years. And you didn't want to share your journey, but I thought that maybe I could make an attempt doing so. And I hope that there are some life lessons that you find common, and maybe there is lots to take back on the for the entrepreneurship in us, in her, and all of us. So I was always tagged a minority profile. So my parents in the 1970s had a mixed religion marriage. My father is an Indian Muslim. My mother is a Pakistani Hindu. I know, it's strange. What are the chances of that happening? But it happened. Okay. I come from a family of, we have a tradition of theater and storytellers. And so they shared that common passion, and that brought them together. And they married against all sort of odds in the 1970s without realizing the backlash that it may just entail. So they thought, oh, that only happens in movies. That doesn't happen in real life, you know. But it did happen. So they faced a lot of ostracization, isolation, lack of social structures. Almost everything collapsed around in their lives after the wedding. And my mother was promptly disowned by her family because you don't marry a Muslim. And my father's family didn't entirely disown him, but it was more subtle. So from a very young age, we were kind of this strange sort of unit where we were completely in one corner. So then I had a name like Chandni Jafri. And in school, you know, I was getting bullied a lot, because including teachers, and they'd say, what is Chandni Jafri? It's very confusing for me. What are you, a Muslim or a Hindu? And I said, you know what? You have no idea. It's equally confusing for me, because I can't figure out what's going on. So I came back home and I said, Dad, you know, I'm really getting bullied. Everybody's asking me. I don't have an answer. So I thought I'd check back and get back to you. I told them, I said, wait, I'll check. So I asked my dad, I said, Dad, everybody's asking me, you're a Hindu or a Muslim, who are you? So he said, who's asking you this? I said, everybody's asking me that. He's saying, tell them you're an Indian. I said, okay. I said, but what is my so-called religion? He's saying, well, you get to choose. I said, you get to choose, as in how? See, nobody's born into a religion, you get to choose. I give you the choice. I said, okay, so which means what? When do I get to choose? He said, now. And I was 7 then. I said, oh. So how do I go around choosing it? He's saying, see, you read the Bible, you read the Quran, you read the Gita. And he's telling me all that when I'm 7. I said, so much of reading to do, it seems like a lot of hard work. So it's okay, this decision can wait. A couple of months down the line, I came back from school and I told my dad, I said, Dad, listen, I've chosen. Now I'm a Buddhist. So he's saying, wow, I mean, but okay, I mean, nice choice, but why? I said, one, there are no books to read. And it's easy. And you know Richard Gere, and you know Tina Turner, and you know Dalai Lama came to my school, and he's really cute. And he smiled, and he gave us chutti. So I think this is the religion to follow. From this point on, please, I am a Buddhist, please start writing. Don't leave my religion column empty, which he used to do. I said, please start filling Buddhist. So ever since then, I've fancied myself as a Buddhist for some reason, because it's easy. And also because I thought it was outside of the dogmas and it's more peaceful. But I was wrong. But most importantly, I think what I wanted to share with you is, in all of this, because I was given the choice and the flexibility to take my own time and decide, even if it was a random reason, I realized that my dad gave me very strong life lessons. He told me what's in a name. He told me that you can get to choose your religion. And then later on, when I was struggling with life, he also told me that you could be anything you want to be, whatever you put your mind to. And he also told me that it doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. That's just technicality. So I realized over time, my life lesson number one, and I'd like to share with all the entrepreneurs here who felt isolated, ostracized, alone, because entrepreneurship is a very, very alone journey. It's you're really on your own. So every time you feel that, you must know that you're on the right track, absolutely on the right track, because there is great strength in minority. It's fantastic to be having, you know, not having a majority view, because which means that you can bring about that change that you are meant to. And I've learned this, that adversity, rejection, social isolation, they're great learning grounds for change leaders. And unless you face that, you will not become a change leader, because you have to kind of step onto that side to see what it is like to succeed. And I'd like to quote Martin Luther King Jr., where he said, almost always the creative, dedicated minority has made the world a better place, always. Okay, the another thing I learned was, and I'd like to pass this on to the entrepreneurs here, is this whole thing of living by default, right? Which is that, and I'm talking from a context of entrepreneurship, where we may have a dream, but I'm not very sure how I'm going to achieve it 10 years down the line. I don't have a long-term view on it. And also, I don't know whether it really deeply resonates with me. Like somebody said, I had 20 lakhs and I don't know what to do with it. That's not a dream. That's really not what resonates with your inner core. So that means you're living by default, right? And I'll come to what it means by what it means to live by design. Second is, if you don't have any concrete plan to how to reach your dreams. So they're dreams, but you're really taking no concrete actions to do it. And also, you're not consistent in your efforts. If this is how you define yourself, you're not really being an entrepreneur and you're not going to succeed. But instead, and I've learned it the hard way, really. Sorry for the formatting on the slides. I hope you can read it. Can you read? Okay. So what it says is that when you live by design, you actually align yourself to a purpose. And it may just sound very crazy. What is this purpose alignment? But it just, you have to just answer this question as to what makes you feel happy and alive. What makes you get off your bed every morning saying, hey, this is what I'm going to do today. And that's your purpose. It's that simple. It's nothing big. Whatever makes you really, truly, deliriously happy is your purpose. And your mission then becomes is, how can I share this happiness? How can I make others feel the same? How can I make make them also sort of partake into this journey? And then everything that flows from there, which is your dreams and your goals and your action plan or your consistency, all of it will find a rhythm. And that will make the difference between you being a successful or an unsuccessful entrepreneur. So I'm not saying that if you live by default, you will not be successful. You may just be successful, but you won't be happy doing what you're doing. So I think this is, so all of us should take some time to internally reflect about who we are, take some time off, and just try and constantly answer this question for your own self. What makes me happy? Okay, I also want to talk about, this section was talking about where women stand in our society, not just our society in India, but rest of the world. And just give a perspective of what has been done and what needs to get done, and then I can dive into the next panel that we get into. So as you know, I'm a Buddhist, as I just said. So I did go back to a lot of sutras after I got over Richard Gere and you know all that. And so you'll be surprised that in many Buddhist sutras, it was taught that women could never become a Buddha. Who's a Buddha? Buddha is a totally enlightened, lot of wisdom, courage, like nirvana, will not be attained by women. And one sutra also reads saying that even if the eyes of the Buddhas of the three existences were to fall to the ground, how not a man or a woman of any realms of existence could ever attain Buddhahood. Okay. So this in no doubt reflects the prevailing view of women in India in the 5th century BC. These are the earlier sutras. And so most of us who follow the sutra blindly would be advised otherwise, because and it can be from any religious thought, because it mostly reflects the social, cultural or dominant thought of that time. So it's not the gospel truth. In 13th century Japan, there is a Japanese priest who did a lot of research on Buddhist sutras. And he actually said this, that when I, Nichiren, read the sutras other than the Lotus Sutra, I have not the slightest wish to become a woman. One sutra condemns women as emissaries of hell, another describes them as large snakes. This is in the books. Then he stresses, among the teachers of the Lotus Sutra, that of women attaining Buddhahood is the foremost. So there was some progressive movement within the Buddhism sect. And then they started realizing that, you know, and they started telling the truth, which is none of the above that you saw. And only in the Lotus Sutra do we read that woman who embraces this sutra not only excels all other women, but surpasses all men. So there is really no distinction. So if you do a lot of research, you will also find this truth in the books. Let's come to 20th century. And we are talking Europe, which is France, UK. In as late as 1900s, it was actually legal to beat your wife as long as the stick was narrower than the man's thumb. There are still such laws, regressive laws, which are still in existence. In France, you could beat your woman legally. It was accepted, and it was even endorsed. As long as you didn't kill her, it's okay. This is the society we've lived in for women. It has been so. Having said that, I thought that we could address some of the real issues which are on the ground. We made a lot of progress, but there's so much more to do. For example, we all know the statistics is all around us. If you were to have a more inclusive sort of arrangement and you would include more women into the ecosystem, how it is good for economy, how it's good for families, how it's good for countries, how it's good for the globe. But is it happening? Is it really happening? There are some great stories out there, but there are so many more stories which need to get told, and there's so much work yet to get done on the ground. So, like you say that, we know that if women had equal employment, women could raise every country's GDP, but we still don't have that. So as per statistics, if more women were employed or equal opportunity was given to them, the GDP would right now, as we talk, increase by 5%. Is it being done? We know that. Economically, it's been, there are case studies to demonstrate that. If companies were to put women in leadership positions, they would both benefit. We have research to show us that. Right, but if you see the board composition across the world, globally, not just India, is sometimes minuscule, minority, or at best 13-15%. That's it. It's never come into a league of equal representation, so women don't really have a voice. If women were more politically involved, there would be better policy for poor, the families would benefit because they invest back, whatever women earn, invest back into their households. But are they given those opportunities? Similar for political office. In fact, as you know, STEM or highly skilled training or computer science, it's still, if they were to contribute more and become involved with that, there are statistics which tell us that the tech market will grow by 10% today as we talk. And well, I don't know about the corruption part. I think that's only, that's historical, that if women were given more, because I think that's systemic. And I don't exactly agree with that statistic. But I'm just saying numbers are all around us for a compelling case of how we need to create economic cases for why, what we need to do. But why aren't we doing so? Why isn't it happening? So we need these sporadic events. And when Anas told me about it, I kind of came just for this, because this is so wonderful, what he's trying to put together, what Hurun is trying to do across the world. And I think this whole idea of, in China, 115, you said, billionaires, and in India, we only have 5 self-made billionaires, is a huge gap, which is symptomatic of what?
which is symptomatic of, I believe, is the fact that we are not taking responsibility. I don't think after a while somebody else can deny opportunity to you unless you don't take responsibility and don't earn up. So I just want to share some of the lessons that I have learned, and there are just two more points that I want to talk about is, can we really challenge our own inner transformation and believe that we are deserving and we have the potential to do, and understand there is a task in hand and kind of take ownership for that? Because nobody else, if you've seen historically, nobody else can give you freedom, you take freedom, you know? So it's if you're waiting for somebody else to come and give you an idea so that you can launch an enterprise, it'll never happen. So you have to take the lead and responsibility to make sure that you move forward. Also, hold courageous dialogues, open houses, open forums, use social media. There's so much of me. Use it positively. Use it to influence minds. Use it to change and challenge paradigms. Use it and go out there and hold dialogues and open forums. And also believe that it's possible. It's happened before. So it's possible today and even more so. And I believe that humanity is set to change in the next 20 years what we've not seen in the last 300 years. So that's the pace of change. And so if you're not able to kind of dip into that, it'll be an opportunity lost for centuries, for not just our gender, for everybody. So I just want to leave these thoughts before I actually wanted to, we could dive into the other.